Thank you, Mr. Minister, for your tremendous words of friendship. You also say divine providence. You know that in Israel, the businessmen make a local call to God. But it's possible to have the global networks of communications. Even that can be spread, and it is spreading. There is a great fruits of progress that are being spread across the globe with the openness of markets, with the rise of technology. And this is the subject that I'd like to speak about in this historic visit to Mexico. Historic because, amazingly, no Israeli prime minister has visited Mexico, or for that matter, any other Latin American country since the founding of the State of Israel. It's time to correct it. I'm proud to be the first Israeli prime minister to correct this. It was never appropriate, but it's particularly inappropriate now when it's very clear that Latin America itself has a great future, and then Mexico is one of the great economies of the world. It's in the opening dozen, and by clear and I think responsible estimates, it will move not merely into the top 10, but further down. That means up. And we in Israel want to do business with Mexico. Our firms are here. We have about 150 firms already in Mexico. There's a delegation that came with me, Mr. Minister, with the help of our distinguished ambassadors. I want to thank you, Ambassador Pellet, and you, Ambassador Mesado, for this. It is something whose time has come. Now, I want to say something about what is coming, what is already here, what we have to do. I believe that there is a fundamental change in the economic affairs of nations and people. And that is not merely globalization, but the enormous value of innovation. Innovation changes, creates new industries, and changes old industries with great rapidity. Some will be immune to innovation for a while, but not for long. And the future belongs to those who innovate. So you can take an old industry and make it new. I was once, many, many years ago, a young officer. And I was given a car. It was an Israeli-made car. It was made of fiberglass. You're not laughing. I leaned on the car once, and my elbow went right through the fiberglass, and the fibers scratched my elbow. So you understand that our car industry didn't last long. It collapsed. We could never compete with the production of engines or chassis or parts or wheels. We didn't have the scale. And we couldn't drive down the unit costs. We now have an exploding car industry. What is that car industry? Do we have any slides in this thing? No? None? Didn't bring any? Too bad. Okay. Well, Israeli technology stops at the water edge. I wanted to show you a few things. But I will anyway, with words. We have 500 startup companies in automotive technology. They are receiving, until recently, $3.5 billion a year of investment. We had nothing to do with it. The government didn't invest a penny in this. It just happened by itself. These people are producing things like Waze. Do they use Waze in Mexico? Yeah, well, it's an Israeli company that was sold for nothing, $1 billion, to Google. I say nothing because it's probably worth many times over that by now. But another company was just sold for $15 billion, and it's called Mobileye, and it basically does autonomous vehicles through artificial intelligence and the collation of data from sensors on the car. $15 billion. I think it was also sold cheap. In any case, Intel gave Mobileye, a company in Jerusalem, the keys to 30 of their businesses worldwide so they can develop it. We didn't do anything. If you went to Israel 10 years ago, you will not see. You will see maybe Mobileye, but none of these other companies, virtually none of them existed. We're creating technologies and we're creating industries and markets almost out of thin air. Here's another one that's growing very rapidly, cyber. In cyber, we invested. We invested quite a bit because we invest in our intelligence services, but as a deliberate policy, we allow the graduates of our intelligence services to form startups and to be able to join, to make partnerships with others, with other companies, with other nationals, and so on. And that's growing. Israel is now accounts for 20% of the global private investment in cybersecurity. That's 200 times our size in the general population. This is an industry that grew out of nothing. Well, it's growing out of the internet economy. And the internet is like a roaring tiger, and on the tiger is a little kitten, it's a big kitten. It's the kitten of cybersecurity. And as the one grows, the other grows. And this, by the way, is an infinite business because there will never be a cybersecurity solution. It's endless. Industry number two. Industry three, I give this just as examples. Industry three is digital health. We are able now to change the way people live, how healthy they are, what diseases they contact, and what diseases we can avoid by preventive medicine or personalized medicine. We're about to do this by taking the data bank of the Israeli population. 98% of the Israeli public has a computerized record card of their medical records for the last 20 years. We're going to take a subset of that, 100,000 people, and have swabs, genetic swabs of their saliva, so we know their genetic composition. And we're going to take a subset of that, 2,000, and have sensors so we can monitor their physical activity. We'll now have a three-layer database from which we believe we can have both preventive medicine, much more efficient, much less costly, and at the same time also develop personalized medicine. These are enormous industries, enormous. I know that people look at IT and they understand the great revolution that has happened, because if you looked at the 10 leading companies in the world in market cap 10 years ago and you look now, you see that five energy companies were there and one IT, Microsoft. Today, one is left, Exxon, went from number one to number five, and five IT companies are there. I'm arguing that you're going to see other companies, or companies that are wedded to IT companies, they themselves will branch out into these areas of applying innovation to every field. We talked quite a bit about agriculture. Today we have a revolution in agriculture, not merely drip irrigation, and I congratulate the Mexican company that had the wisdom to buy Netafim the other day. Great choice. But not only drip irrigation, it's the ability with drone technology to photograph, to have imagery of fields, and to see where you need drip fertilization, drip irrigation, where you don't want it, where you're wasting money. So you can increase the yield of crops. You can increase, we already have, the yield of cows. I always ask this question, it's now an easy one to answer. Which cow produces more milk per cow? No, I'll give you a hint, it's not a French cow. It's not a Dutch cow. It's not even an American cow. It's not a European cow. It's an Israeli cow. It's double the amount of milk per cow than the European cows. And this is all technology because it's a computerized cow. Every moo is computerized. And you just can increase productivity. I give this as examples for any field that you're dealing with, any field that you're dealing in. Mining, infrastructure, energy, agriculture, water, health, transport. You are already in a technological revolution, or you will be, or you don't know that you're in, and that's the worst situation to be in. That's the worst situation to be in. There are very few centers of cross-fertilized technology in the world. There are specializations in many areas. There are countries that excel in one area, or one or two areas, other countries that excel in other areas. There are very few places where you have this cross-fertilization. Israel is one such place, and I think there are very few of them for the moment, for the next decade. And I think that we should, we can't sit on our laurels. We don't think that what we've achieved guarantees that we'll achieve it forever. We have to constantly innovate our innovation. But we know one thing that we have to do is we have to couple this innovation to markets. Without markets, we get nothing. And what better market, what better country to wed Israeli innovation to than Mexico? Mexico is emerging rapidly. It'll be a giant. We believe in Mexico. And I know that many in Mexico believe in Israel. We have a Jewish community that it serves as a human bridge between our two countries and our two cultures, and I admire Mexican culture. I've had the opportunity to come here before, not as prime minister, but enough, even on a brief visit, to understand the great resources from which you draw on. But I think that if we can combine our resources, we can have a tremendous impact for the people of Mexico, for the people of the world, the way the food we eat, the air we breathe, the water we drink, the way we organize our lives, our societies, this can be vastly improved by innovation. Israel is the innovation nation. Mexico and Israel can have a tremendous partnership, and I hope that this visit and my meeting with President Neto will mark, how shall I say this, sounds like Casablanca, the beginning of a beautiful friendship. Well, the continuation of a beautiful friendship. And I thank you for assisting in it. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you.